over this distance, there could be number of fixed WLANs are there on this way, which could be in the CSM range of that particular mobile hotspot. So for this case, the now main question is that what is the performance of this mobile hotspot when there is a varying number of fixed APs are there over this travel distance. So in this problem statement, we have one challenge, which is mobile hotspot has dynamic nature of interference due to its mobility. And for that, we suggested adaptive selection of channel based on whichever is the least congested. And the observation for this study was that we can have the maximum throughput gain, which is equal to 43%, when duration between two channel selection is based on the speed of this mobile EP. And this we can actually see from this graph as well. And so what we see here is that with such a simple channel selection mechanism, we can have really high gain in throughput, so which justifies the need for improved management and coordination in general, more general scenarios as well. So now the next part of the study is we have studied the emulation of multi-path channel with reduced hardware complexity for this. So now for this particular project, I have worked with Larry and Wade. So for multipath channel emulation, so multipath can be represented, so whenever we have multipath channel, the receiver can receive multiple copies of the same signal and with some delay. So such multipath channel response can be defined with this equation, which is tap delay line filter with uniformly tap spacing, which has uniformly tap spacing of 1 over W. And the main two factors are there is RMS delay spread and bandwidth W. And let's say if we have really high RMS delay spread or high bandwidth, this number of taps to represent this channel accurately are really large. So, and this could become, when we have really large number of taps, the hardware emulation complexity could be really high. So here objective is to, can we emulate this multipath channel with using reduced number of taps, which can reduce the complexity.
So and W depends on what?
So W is the bandwidth, and it's a wide band channel if we consider, I mean, if we have really 20 megahertz of channel, or like even the 100 or 200 megahertz of the channel, which is used for communication, then this W could be large there. So for this, we have taken two approach here: the emulation of source to receiver, and for that we have taken three tap approximation, and we are showing that while matching first four moments of power delay profile of the channel. And for emulation of interference links, we can use n taps approximation for each of the interference links, which matches CD of the total interference power. And for this emulation, we have used the PDP, which is which has the equal gain and which is spaced equally among themselves. And what we have observed is that the similar approach we can use as we have used in interference link for the source to receiver as well, just using three taps which has the equal gain as well. And we have seen the good performance for source to receiver approximation as well. And with this approaches, we can have almost 50% reduction in required taps. And this reduction could be even more when we have really high W or high tau RMS values there. And I'm just showing one example of the results here, which is showing the results for interference link with n tap approximation, and m, which is number of interfering links, could be 2, 4, 6. And in this cases, we have taken different values of W tau RMS. And for n-tap approximation, we can see this CDFs are literally overlapping on top of each other. So it matches, this approximation is giving really good accuracy as well. So this was the our isn't there. So now, next, I begin with now building radio coverage map using practical approach through path loss based interpolation. And for this project, I have worked with Larry and Wade. So in this project, now let's say we have the network. There could be multiple emitter, which is AP or base station in the network, and there could be multiple client nodes are there. So the question we would want to ask is that what is the impact of this emitter at client node, let's say at E0, or what is the coverage of E as well? So for this particular, to answer this question, we can assume that there could be number of sensors that are deployed in the network, and we have this, and we also know the locations of the sensors as well. So if we have the receive power samples at each of the sensors, can we use these samples to estimate the impact of E on P0? So that's the problem statement. That's the problem we want to solve here. And for that, we have proposed, we are taking interpolation approach, and which is jointly based on the properties of path loss model and weight assignments, which is based on stochastic analysis and inverse distance weighting mechanism. And we have characterized the performance with respect to density of the sensors or and shadow fading correlation distance. The second one is we have also seen characterize the effect of position of emitter. The third we have taken into account is correlation function itself. And we have compared the proposed approach with the available mechanisms like Krieging, nearest neighbor, natural neighbor, etc. So in this study, we have considered one particular topology of the sensor, and we have taken, there are 4x4 sensors are available, which makes the square geometry. And the distance side of the length of the square is 640, but we'll show that this side of the length of the side of the square does not matter. And E emitter is located outside of this square, and P0 could be located anywhere inside or on the square. That's the particular example we are setting up here. So path loss, we are using the well-known equations for the path loss model, and received power is usually the function of transmission power plus path loss, and here transmission power could be just constant. So we are just going to consider path loss values for now onwards, which could be defined by this particular equation, where A is the path loss constant, gamma is the path loss exponent, and S is the shadow fading, which is zero mean Gaussian random variable with standard deviation sigma. So for shadow fading value, spatial correlation can be defined with this particular function. And ij defines the location, two different locations ij, and dij is the distance between these locations, and x is the shadow fading correlation distance. So having defined this model, now we have this proposed four-step algorithm here. And here objective is to estimate path loss at any arbitrary point P0 surrounded by n sensors. So for this, we have assumed that we already know the all the distances between transmitter and all the sensors. And we have path loss values available at sensor. Having this information, now we can estimate values of A and gamma using least square estimator. And those estimated values are A dash and gamma dash respectively. So once we have used the LSC to calculate this A gamma and A dash and gamma dash at sensor, now we can also have the estimated values of path loss, which is defined by the second equation. But there is some difference between true value of path loss and estimated value of path loss, and that we are calling as a estimated shadow fading at sensors, which is defined by third equation. So once we have that, then the estimated value of path loss at point of estimation, which is P0, is defined by this particular equation. and here the shadow feeding at P0 could be taken as a weighted sum of shadow estimated shadow feeding values at different sensor. So here weights are still unknown. To calculate weights, now we have taken the approach of different approaches here. So we have proposed three different algorithm: SM0, SM1, and SM2. SM0 is the ideal algorithm, and which is exactly same as the ideal simple Kaiken. And in this case, what we assume that we know exact value of A and gamma, and W can be defined by the weight vector at each of the sensor can be defined by this middle and first equation, where small c is the shadow feeding correlation vector between P0 and sensor, and capital value of C is the shadow feeding correlation matrix among all the sensors, and D is the distance vector between P0 and sensor itself. So this SM0 is basically we can see that this SM0 can give the lower bound for the error. So that's we are going to consider as a baseline in our study. The second SM1 assumes that we don't know exact value of A and gamma, that we are going to calculate through LAC now. But the W weights value for weights value we are still going to use the correlation function there. And the SM2, which is the next approach, which is more practical. The reason is that in practice it's not possible to have perfect correlation values available. So we cannot rely on those values. So we are going to consider distance value instead. And the weights are given based on, let's say, one particular sensor is closely located at from P0. Then proportionally that sensor will get proportionally a higher value than other sensors. So that's how we are going to apply this inverse distance weights method there. And for A and gamma, again, we are going to estimate these values here. So now having these three mechanisms, I'm just showing the one particular instance for estimation of path loss for one instance of shadow feeding values. And for this particular, so left hand side graph shows the true path loss values, and the right hand side shows the estimated value, and we can still see, okay, there is a good match, but certainly we need to quantify this RMS error value, which I'm going to do in the next few slides. And for this particular case, I have assumed that the emitter is located outside of the square at location -100, 0, considering there is a 0, 0 coordinate for one particular sensor, and with respect to that E is located outside. So now this slide shows the effect of sensor spacing, and in the left hand side graph shows the comparison between SM0, SM1, SM2, and here to show the effect of sensor spacing, we have considered one particular fraction, which is D over XC, where D is the length of the side of the square and XC is the correlation. So our observation is that in all the cases, fraction of D over XC or the ratio of D over XC matters, not the individual value of D and XC. So that's why we are just going to use this ratio from all our results from now on. And so x-axis is D over XC, and RMS error in dB is the y-axis. So from this graph shows that the SM0 now is giving the lower bound of the error, which can be seen here, and SM1, SM2 are literally matching with or they are overlapping on top of each other. So even though now SM1 has the extra information about the correlation, and SM2 is just using the distance value, still they are overlapping for this particular case. And in the right hand side graph, so we are just going to now consider SM2, which is the practical approach, and that we are comparing with available method, which is NN, nearest neighbor IDW, and natural neighbor NAN. So, and SM2 is behaving better than the available approaches.
So before you go on, can you provide an interpretation for what D over XC is? So D over XC at value of 1 versus D over XC at a value of 8, let's say.
So, yeah, surely. So D over XC, so for example, if we have D is equal to 640 in our case, then XC is also 640. So D over XC, when it's like really low, then it means that all the sensors are located, our density is very high because of the correlation distance as well. So I mean, so when we have
it's not because of, you mean relative to?
Yeah, related to correlation distance. I mean, if the correlation, if the shadow feeding are going to correlate for really high value, if the correlation are going to exist, let's say up to 1000 meters, then it's really not necessary to have the sensor located, let's say, at 10 meter value. So they can still be at very far away, but they can still give really good results in such case. So for example, in open space where this correlation distance would be really high, then we need really few sensors deployed. But for example, in the scenarios like New York City, where the correlation distance is really small, then in that case, we need to have high deployment of the sensor so that we can accurately capture the effect of this received power.
So intuitively speaking, what does correlation distance capture?
So correlation distance capture, how closely shadow fading at one point is matching with the shadow fading at the other location. So that's what shadow fading correlation distance is defining.
So in your original slide or two, you presented the correlation function, Cij, which you used the exponential model. Can you bring that up a bit? So go back like 10 slides. That one right there, right? Maybe not 10. So when D is XC, then you've got like a 1 over E factor in there.
Do you capture the height of the emitter in the cleaner model, right? I don't think the emitter height is taken into account in any.
No, I mean, I had just taken into path, I mean, I kept just as a standard path loss equation, but we didn't really capture the effect of the emitter height in this case.
Okay.
But that's a good point, actually. That would matter a lot as well in this case.
And you emphasize that you assume you know the location of the emitter.
Yes, yeah. So, yeah, now this slide is showing the effect of emitter as well. So now we have moved emitter to minus 100, 320, which is bisecting this square here. So this is particular, case was very interesting because it was giving the worst case scenario or worst case error for our study. So again, SM0 is giving lowest lower bound for the RMS error, and SM1, SM2, they're on top of each other. And we can see that distinctly that SM2 is behaving much better than all other available approaches here. And which is for the worst case emitter location scenario. So we are pretty much good here.
Can you explain intuition behind that again? Why does this stochastic, your method do better than the?
The reason is that we are taking path loss into account, and so which is helping a lot, I mean, to calculate this A and gamma values. And others are pretty much, I mean, they're not considering this A and gamma, and rather it's solely taking distance values or the area values as a weights. That's why we have like some additional information apart from these weights values. So that's why it's helping a lot to improve this error here.
So I had a similar but question, but it was actually specifically about this case.
Mm-hmm.
So why is this case worse than, say, the previous case? Why did you observe that? This geometry.
Actually, geometry here is, it's very interesting. So here, if we see the distance between E and sensors which are nearest to that, if they are equidistant, and from and the distance from E to these two sensors, they are equidistant. So it is actually equivalent to having, we have for two distances, we might be observing different path loss values. So it is as good as having just two values versus four values. So that's the reason behind it. So for previous case, for example, we have four different values of distances available, and for four different values, we had four different values of path loss were there. So we have 4 points for estimation for with respect to distances. Versus here, only two values of distinct distances available, but there are four different path loss values are there, and that's why it has the it's much prone to having error than the previous case. That was the reason behind it.
So there's degeneracy in the geometry.
Okay. So now the third result is effect of correlation function. And for this particular case, we have considered locus of constant correlation is elliptical. In earlier cases, this locus was constant correlation was circle, but now in this case, it's elliptical with some rotation angle is there, and there is unequal minor and major axis are there. So even for this one, so by intuitively having correlation value or correlation functions should help us a lot. So we are expecting higher or the lower RMSE error in case of SM1 than SM2. So we are seeing some difference in this error as well. SM1 is behaving better, but there is not much gap is there. Still, SM2 is behaving considerably better even in this case as well. So that's why we are just keeping this SM2 to compare with NAN and IDW. And here I haven't actually shown the nearest neighbor because it's consistently behaving bad. And even in this case, the SM2 is much better than this IDW and NAN approach as
so
well.
So quick question. So I think the last 3-4 slides, I think, first correct me if I'm wrong. Stating this, that given a emitter position, the way the sensors are placed matters in terms of accuracy of path loss estimates, right? So if I turn it around, given emitter location, is there an optimal way to place minimum number of sensors? Is there a
given emitter location? So certainly actually that can happen. So
a simple example where emitter is at the corner of a square versus if it's in the position where it's kind of halfway, right?
So that is certainly we can have that intuition as well. I mean, we certainly need to have, let's say, four distinct value of distances in this case, so that we have the more points for our curve fitting. Basically, I mean, here we are doing curve fitting pretty much, and exactly. I mean, having the emitter location, we can have like some little bit random or like some kind of
geometry. From a computational geometry standpoint, are there, if I give you X number of sensors, best positions to place them or vice versa, minimum number of locations required? Again, we can take this into closed session, but continue. You have to finish by a certain time, right? The open session. Come to that later.
Okay. So with this, now, the summary for this study is that like SM0 gives the lower bound for RMSE, and RMSE of SM1 and SM2 are indistinguishable from each other, and but certainly SM2 is like more a practical approach is there, where we have, and between SM2, SM0 and SM0, the gap is not more than 20%. So that's our observation. And what we have observed is that SM2 is behaving much better than the available approaches as well. So that's the good point here. So now with this, I'm going to continue with the last topic for this session, which is dynamic coordination algorithm, where we have studied the particular case of coexistence of Wi-Fi and LTE. And for this project, I have worked with Ivan, Ray, Dola, and Unath undergrad Sam here. So the problem statement is that we have number of Wi-Fi and LTE small cells which are coexisting in same spectrum band, and when there is a high density of these networks are there, then there are going to be a lot of interference, and we need to mitigate this interference and improve the performance. And for this study, first when we begin with this study, there was no interference model was available there, so we begin with first the interference characterization between these two systems. And once we characterized that, we wanted to have some kind of validation for our model, so we could actually perform some experiment on orbit testbed for this using USRP based LTE nodes and 11G Wi-Fi devices in the orbit testbed. And then we proposed logically centralized cooperative optimization framework using power and time control optimization. So, the interference took a model throughput of a single Wi-Fi in the presence of a single interference. We have considered that when there is no LTE is present, then Wi-Fi throughput is a function of SNR, and Wi-Fi has this carrier sensing, which is when there is another Wi-Fi is present, then when it detects, it just backs off some for some random amount of time. But now let's say, for example, LTE is present, and in such case, Wi-Fi cannot detect LTE is present, but it just sees some noise is there. If that noise in that band is higher than some threshold, here we are calling that as a lambda C, then Wi-Fi see, okay, channel is busy and it backs off, but the total energy in the band or noise energy in the band is less than this threshold, then Wi-Fi see, okay, channel is clear and it transmits. But certainly the SINR will be less in such case. So we are using that property here. So when no LTE is there, then the Wi-Fi throughput is a function of SNR. But now when LTE is present, if the band energy is higher than threshold, then no Wi-Fi transmission, throughput is just equal to zero in this case. But now if the LTE is present, then the throughput is a function of SINR along with the consideration of LTE here. And similarly, we can model the throughput of a single LTE in the presence of a single Wi-Fi. So when no Wi-Fi is present, the throughput of LTE is a function of SNR. But now when Wi-Fi is present and Wi-Fi is getting shut off because of the LTE interference, then there is no interference from Wi-Fi, and LTE throughput is equal to as if there is no Wi-Fi is present. But if Wi-Fi could transmit, then LTE throughput is a function of SINR along with the consideration of interference there. So once we have this model, now we need to have some experimental validation, and for that we have considered one particular topology on an orbit testbed, and for that we could do the throughput performance check for Wi-Fi throughput when some other interference is present, and that other interference could be Wi-Fi or LTE as well. So in this case, now Wi-Fi AP and associated Wi-Fi, I'm calling that as a UE here. The distance between them is fixed, which is 0.25. So when there is no interference is present, throughput is always high. So and first this link, there is some interfering AP is there, and the distance between this interfering AP and Wi-Fi link is varied between 1 meter to 20 meter. And we had done this experiment in 2.4 gigahertz, and Wi-Fi bandwidth 20, and LTE bandwidth would be 5 and 10. And we had done LTE implementation using open air interface here. So now we have this experiment results. So left hand side figure shows the Wi-Fi throughput, and red color is experimental throughput, and black color line is the analytical throughput. And we can see that, and x-axis here the interference distance between Wi-Fi link and interference, and y-axis is the throughput, Wi-Fi throughput. And for this particular experiment, we have considered LTE is operating at 5 MHz of bandwidth, which is lightly loaded. It means it just consists of control channel itself. So accordingly, the simulation parameters for the analytical model has been modified. And we can see that there is very close match between analytical and experimental throughput. So which is kind of confirming the model at least partially. And we did another set of experiment here, where we have changed the source of interference to Wi-Fi. LTE operating at 5 MHz, LTE operating at 10 MHz, and again Wi-Fi throughput is shown. So when there is no interferences there, then Wi-Fi throughput is very close to 22 Mbps. And whenever other Wi-Fi is present, the throughput gets reduced by half. But whenever LTE is present, this throughput reduction is not half, but it's the much larger degradation is happening there. And we can see that here, when LTE is operating on 10 versus 5, we can certainly see there is a much difference in that performance as well. Again, in this case, LTE is like partially loaded. It's pretty much the, it did have control signals only. So with this exercise, what we achieve is that, like, we first validated this interference model, and at the same time, we can see that when there is no coordination is there, we are seeing really large degradation in the throughput performance. So we need to have some coordination mechanism then. So we propose this logically central optimization method, for which we assume that location, channel gain, frequency are the known parameters. Objective is to maximize system throughput, along with the constraint that there should be some minimum data rate requirement at user. And approaches we are taking is power control and time division channel access, which I'll go through in detail. So for power control, we have controlled the downlink power at both Wi-Fi and LTE, and using geometric programming here. And the objective function is to maximize system throughput, which is Wi-Fi plus LTE, and along with the constraint of minimum data requirement at both of them. And also, we have considered clear channel requirement at Wi-Fi LTE, so at no point Wi-Fi LTE should be shut off. And there is, we have consideration for the range of transmission power as well. And for Wi-Fi parameter, we have also taken into account the duty cycle of Wi-Fi, which is a function of how many CSMA nodes are there in the network around that Wi-Fi access point. And also we have taken into account the throughput reduction due to hidden node scenarios in the network. So the second optimization approach is time division channel access, and for that we have optimized how much fraction of the time we should allocate to each Wi-Fi and LTE individually so that they won't operate at the same time. But at the same time, and we have taken maximum fairness for that. So it means we are going to we are maximizing here minimum throughput at Wi-Fi and LTE network, and we are controlling the fraction of time each network should have here. And for this particular optimization, we are doing some stage zero as well, where first we are optimizing power at each of the network individually. So having this solutions, we are comparing this both the solutions with one particular scenario here. And for that, now we are considering UE8. This is just a single Wi-Fi link and single LTE link available. That's the assumption is here. So let's say now UE8 is located at 00 and associated APA is at it's varied from distance 0 at 0 to 100 here, and this BA value is varying. So for each of the value of BA, we are having interfering APB, and that for APB is also distance between APB and UEA, that is also varying for each of the value of DA. And based on where exactly APB is located, whether it's on the negative x-axis or positive x-axis, we are calling that either minus DI or plus DI. We are taking this particular notation. The reason is that the distance between these two AP matters because of the CCA of the Wi-Fi. So now in this case, if the link A is Wi-Fi, then APB is the LTE and vice versa. So and for this simulation, we have taken into account Wi-Fi is 11N, and both Wi-Fi LTE is fully loaded and operating at 20 MHz of bandwidth. So now these are the simulations result, and I'm showing here the throughput of a LTE link in the presence of interfering Wi-Fi AP. Here the x-axis is AP UA distance, which is DA, and y-axis is interference AP UA distance, and each of the in this heat map we are showing the throughput here. So the throughput ranges when the blue region is very close to zero, and then red region is very high throughput, or the max is very close to maximum throughput. And the first graph is showing low coordination, and then power control and time division optimization here. So now we can see that when no coordination is provided, then LTE throughput is very much close to this blue, which is very low throughput. And for this particular no coordination graph, we are seeing there is one interesting diagonal band is there where LTE throughput is really high. So that particular band is showing that for that region, LTE is making Wi-Fi to shut off, and as there is no Wi-Fi interferences there, we are observing really high LTE throughput there. So now when we go from no coordination to power control optimization, we can see that like lot of blue region has vanished, and the throughput for most of the region is gone up. And we can also see that the diagonal band has got reduced. It means that this power optimization is helping for Wi-Fi as well, as it is shut off for lower region as well. But still, we can see that the LTE throughput is still very close to zero for some region, and Wi-Fi throughput is zero for some region. So its power control is infeasible for many of the regions. So that's why we go for this time division channel access, and we can see that the Wi-Fi LTE throughput is almost high for all the region, and this throughput is half of the what LTE could achieve. It's roughly.
That's why I just wanted to point out, you should point out in your result that this large blue region on the left curve indicates that LTE is also quite severely affected by Wi-Fi, but conventionally people think that LTE will do very well and Wi-Fi will just shut off. So I think we should make that point clear.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, when no coordination is there, both the system is performance is getting bad.
Wi-Fi is affected more severely, then I guess that's your next chart.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But power control doesn't help much.
No. I mean, especially in some region, it's certainly infeasible. There is no optimized solution is available.
So I was just going to ask or bring up that you're showing the throughput of the LTE link, and you're saying that that Wi-Fi has backed off. Mm-hmm. But you should actually show that here. You should show the throughput for the Wi-Fi link, just to say, look, nothing was happening, nothing was going through. We did do that. But.
Yeah, so we that is going to be on the next graph right now. So similarly, for Wi-Fi, I'm plotting this graph, and here we can actually see the similar thing.
That's not what I meant. I meant, if you go back to the previous case, this is the case of interfering Wi-Fi, and looking at the throughput of the LTE, like you should also look at what the Wi-Fi AP managed to get through. Which you have, you just didn't present that. Because it's, you know, they're two systems.
But that is the next plot.
No, the next plot's a different scenario. Next plot.
His question is, are these plots for two different scenarios, or are you showing the plot for the same scenario, Wi-Fi throughput and LTE throughput? I think his point is, you want to also see what's happening to Wi-Fi at the same time, right? Is Wi-Fi getting
completely... You explained to us that Wi-Fi is shutting off for this case. And I know it's true, but you should show that.
Is it the same scenario in the next one?
They're opposite plots. If you go to the next one, what you wrote, go ahead to the next one. Now the LTE is acting as the node A, and it's the Wi-Fi that you're...
It's opposite, but it's similar. I mean, it's pretty much the similar train. It's still following the same train as well. I mean, in this case, even though we are moving the LP link there, but those still two graph, those are like corresponding on each other.
There's a geometry mapping that you have to make, which, you know, same point on this curve doesn't match the same point on the previous curve.
No, it doesn't do that. But the train is pretty much the same for both of these. So this is now for Wi-Fi, and as we can see, no coordination. Most of the region is blue, which is no throughput area. And when we go from no coordination to power control, certainly there is some improvement for most of the region. But many region is still infeasible. Power control is infeasible with zero throughput, and for when it goes from power control to time division, the throughput is, non-zero throughput is possible for all the region, and this throughput is almost half of the what Wi-Fi could achieve. So it's rough value there.
So what type of CCF algorithm did you have in this simulation? Is it spectral energy detection, or there's some particle code on Wi-Fi and pilot detection on it? Because the CCA assessment will matter in terms of the characterization of impact even further, right?
Yeah, so I just assumed the spectral energy detection. So this threshold is minus 62 dBm, I'm assuming, over this 20 MHz of bandwidth. And I'm just trying, okay, if the overall Wi-Fi LTE interference is above that, then the Wi-Fi is not going to transmit. So, and this was just in the simulation, so I just assumed the spectral energy value for interference.
So if I had changed the sensitivity of CCA to even further, right, do you see the number of additional data points that get impacted from the deterioration throughput perspective? Did you do any of that?
No, actually, I didn't do that, but we can certainly, do this very easily with this and change the sensitivity and see how much it's really affecting for both the system. Yes, actually, that we can do as a further evaluation as well. And now, the last result of this presentation is I'm showing Wi-Fi plus LTE evaluation when multiple Wi-Fi and multiple LTE links are there. So N is the number of Wi-Fi link here, or the number of active links is N, which is number of Wi-Fi links equal to number of LTE links. And here, N value can be 2, 5, and 10. The left-hand side graph shows the 10 percentile throughput across both Wi-Fi and LTE. And so this basically shows the worst case throughput in the system. And for no coordination, it's almost equal to zero. When it goes from no coordination to power control, there is some improvement is there. And for time division channel access, certainly the throughput gain is highest. And this trend is consistent for all the possible, even though number of links increases in the system. And the right-hand graph shows the Wi-Fi, fraction of Wi-Fi throughput in Wi-Fi plus LTE throughput. And so when there is no, when number of links are really low, which is 2, for example, here, then even in that case, for no coordination, fraction of Wi-Fi throughput is really low. With power control, it's almost it increases pretty well. And for time division, it's almost close to 0.5. The share of the throughput for both Wi-Fi and LTE is almost 50-50%. And this trend pretty much goes same for number of link equal to 2, 5 and 10. And we are seeing some decrease in the like throughput share as for Wi-Fi as it number of links increases, but that is due to the effect of backoff and collision in the Wi-Fi. So that's why that effect is shown here. In summary, now we investigated inter-system interference and observed severe performance degradation in both the system for LTE and Wi-Fi. And we also provided experimental validation for this coexistence model. And we proposed network level cooperation for this for LTE and Wi-Fi coexistence, and we observed significant improvement in performance, and especially it also introduces the fairness in the system as well. So now with this, I'll come to the conclusion of my thesis presentation. So we recognize broad challenges of associated to spectrum coexistence for emerging wireless system, and we also propose radio interference mapping tools and coordination algorithm for dynamic spectrum management. And improvement is achieved in terms of throughput, resource utilization. It could be radio utilization or hardware utilization, and we can also improve the fairness in the system as well. In future direction, we can validate this network APIs on the testbed, and also we can take the more approach towards the heuristic. We can take heuristic approach to replace complex algorithm. For one study, we have taken more practical approach for to build radio coverage map, but similarly we can do for the LTE and Wi-Fi as well. So with this, I'm going to conclude. So this is the list of my publications. And in last, I am not missed at all. I would like to acknowledge all my advisors here, Peer, Larry, Barry, for such a wonderful support throughout my PhD. They have given it to me. And I would like to thank Milin for coming here and supervising my thesis here. And I would like to thank Ivan as well, as he's not here, but he has helped a lot throughout all this like questions, especially on the Wi-Fi LTE project. And I would like to thank all my research collaborator, to Sam as well, who has like wonderfully helped me with the last part for my experiments. And I would like to thank Abhi for such like being so big support system for me, my family, and awesome lab mates and friends as well. Thank you so much, all of you. And thank you.